Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I, Muskan Bhate, extend the heartiest welcome to each one of you present for the second edition of All in City Literature Festival organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. I'm your anchor for this session, and topic for this session is Fantastic Failures, What Can They Teach Us? The speaker for this session is Sonali Mishra, ma'am. Sonali Mishra, ma'am, is an author and PhD researcher in publishing studies at the University of Stirling, UK. Her debut non-fiction book, 21 Fantastic Failures and What Their Stories Teach Us, was released from Rupa Publications in September 2020. Her writing has also appeared in British and Indian anthologies. She worked in the Indian publishing industry for 4 years and is the co-chair of the Society of Young Publishers, Scotland. Sonali ma'am is also the co-founder of the Silky Publications, CIC, an international literary magazine that promotes and publishes underrepresented voices. We welcome you, ma'am.
Moderator for this session
is Kritika Dhanwate, ma'am. Kritika Dhanwate, ma'am, is a businesswoman with a degree in engineer and master's in science and sustainable building technology from UK. She is a director of KKE Group of companies, which offers automatic vehicle cleaning machinery and chemicals, and channel partners for brand Greaves and Ampere for electric vehicles and Ledwin's Awesome for their lighting solutions. Kritika ma'am is passionate about the environment and animals and constantly working on eco-friendly techniques and technologies. I would like to hand over this session to Kritika ma'am.
Thank you, Muskan. Thank you. And thank you, All in City Literature Fest, for giving everyone an opportunity to listen to such great and knowledgeable authors. So, coming to the topic now, failures are called stepping stones to success. But why is it always that we see failure so negatively? Why is it we are always so scared to fail? Sonali Mishra, author of 21 Fantastic Failures, here today, in her book has given an interesting perspective towards failure. Let's talk to her and find out more. So, Sonali ma'am, what is 21 Fantastic Failures all about?
So my book, 21 Fantastic Failures, well, first of all, hello everyone. Sorry for the little delay. And thanks again, Kritika, for chairing this, and Orange City Literature Festival for having me on. Back to your question. 21 Fantastic Failures, my book, is a different kind of, I don't know how to categorize it really. It's like a biography, self-help mix and nonfiction, but it's got like lots of trivia in it as well. It presents the life stories of 21 icons from various fields, and then looks at a moment they all failed. And then we study that moment, we learn the decision they made then, and the quality they displayed then, and how we can adapt that into our own lives. I wanted to present the stories as almost fables for grown-ups, because we've all grown up reading fairy tales and moral stories that teach us lessons like unity is strength, a bird in hand is worth two in the bush. But as we grow up, we need stories that are more than just, you know, stories about princes and princesses or like farmyard animals, because we can't relate to them as adults or grown-ups. So these stories are based on real life, actual people who've walked on our earth, so we can relate to them. But I've structured their stories as fables. So when they reach their point where they failed, I make them reach a crossroads almost. So they have to choose between path one and path two. And spoiler alert, but path one is like the made up imaginary path that I think I or you or someone else would have taken if you were in their shoes, maybe. But path two is the more courageous and like different step they took that turned their failures into successes.
Yeah, very interesting. So can you tell me how, like, tell us all like how the story actually and the book came about, or the story of how the book came out?
Yeah, it's interesting. So everyone, I think a lot of people think that you can only publish books when you get an idea and then you write the book and then you go to a publisher and hopefully they love it. But another way to publish books is that publishers, editors have their own book ideas and they commission, that's the term they use, they commission these ideas to authors. So I was doing a creative writing master's at the University of Edinburgh. I know that's a weird master's degree to do, but that exists. And it was really fun and really like an amazing experience. So I was doing that degree. And I used to work in publishing, as our host mentioned today. So someone I knew previously from a job contacted me on Facebook. I know Facebook helped, saying, "Hi, I saw that you are doing a master's degree in creative writing. Does that mean you like writing and you enjoy writing?" And I said, "Yeah, I mean, I do. I'm doing this degree." So she said that I'm now working as an assistant commissioning editor at one of the leading publishers in India, Rupa Publications. And she said, "I have an idea for a book and I'm looking for an author to write it for me." And that she had already been to 2-3 writers for it. They had written samples for her, but they didn't really gel with her. So she asked me if I could write a sample for her, which, you know, I was just finishing my degree and someone comes and hands me this golden opportunity. So obviously I jumped for joy for this. But I was also a bit hesitant because I hadn't really attempted nonfiction before, which I informed her of. I said that I only do short stories. Usually I'm working on a novel. I don't know if I can do this. So she said, no, go ahead. You know, just give it a shot. Just write me a sample chapter. Like, what's the worst that could happen, right? Because I didn't have a book deal right now. If she rejects it, I won't have a book deal again. It's the same thing. So I went back, and because I like writing stories and not nonfiction as such, I then wrote this nonfiction book like a collection of short stories. That's why I took that creative twist of making it into a fable, like I mentioned. And I sent the sample chapter to her. And they must have liked it because then they offered me the book deal. So that's how this book came about. So the publisher and the editor had the title in mind already, which I think is a really catchy, nice title. And they had a few lists of, they have like 5 or 6 names in the list. But then the structure and the little twist I've given it and the rest of the names on the list are like me. So that's where we've collaborated together to produce this book.
So coming to the names on the list, so can you tell us more about who all are featured in the book?
Yeah, sure. I really wanted a nice mixture of names. So I wanted both men and women, like definitely women, because I think they're underrepresented when you talk about like success stories or failures. And I definitely wanted a mix of ethnicities, a mix of geographical locations, a mix in the fields that they all work in. So I have people working in or who have like made an impact in the fields of business, science, technology, politics, sports, literature, art, film, TV, and music. So basically everything you can think of. And my 21 failures in this book are Amitabh Bachchan, The Beatles, Richard Branson, Julia Child, Walt Disney, Thomas Edison, Albert Einstein, Lady Gaga, Vincent Van Gogh, Steve Jobs, Michael Jordan, Nelson Mandela, Lionel Messi, Elon Musk, Colonel Sanders, Dr. Seuss, Steven Spielberg, Ratan Tata, Vera Wang, Serena Williams, and Oprah Winfrey. So it's got a nice mixture of people. And I think anyone who picks up this book, there's at least one person they will relate to, either because they've come from similar roots or they have similar interests, or it's someone they already might know a bit of, but they want to learn more about. And or they might just, you know, directly relate with one of the moral stories, like moral lessons, or like the lasting lessons, as I call them, which is the moral of the story in each chapter. So I think everyone will relate to at least one person in the book.
Yeah, so maybe not, I'll not say one of your favorite and all your babies in a way, but maybe one section or maybe an excerpt that you could actually read to us. It's always nice to hear it from the author.
Yeah, sure. I get for these excerpts, it's hard to choose which one to read because I could be biased.
That's why I said the whole text is your baby. So I know it's hard to choose.
Yeah, but the one that I picked today is actually one of my favorite chapters. Uh-huh. It's on the life of Oprah Winfrey, the celebrated TV anchor, media personality. You don't even have to say her last name. Everyone just says Oprah and you know who she is.
Yeah.
And I will, because it's an excerpt, I don't want to read the full chapter. I will read the part from when she comes to her crossroads, as I call it, which is basically the moment she's about to fail. And then I will go through the parts 1 and 2 and the lasting lesson. I just have a bit of tea before that.
Please, please.
Okay, here it goes. Oprah wasn't like other journalists. When reporting on a house fire, she offered blankets to the victims and told parents who had lost their children that they didn't have to speak with her about the incident. She was too passionate, too empathetic, and the bosses noted it. She got told off for this humane trait, for caring too much about people rather than the scoop. Moreover, the management felt she didn't look the part of a newscaster, that her hair was too thick, her eyes too far apart, her nose too wide. In other words, they criticized her for her racial features. She was sent to a fancy New York City salon for a makeover. More likely, they tried to make her over into someone she wasn't. Their attempt at a perm utterly failed and ruined her hair, making it all fall off. Not wanting to keep her on anymore, nor wanting to pay out her contract, the management hit upon what they thought was a creative solution: to demote her to a morning slot, making her chance upon her crossroads. Path one. Oh, Oprah knew she was close to being fired. She might be young, but she was no fool. She was aware of the whispers around her. She'd had a good ride the past couple of years, but who was she kidding? Good things didn't happen to her. Her shot at radio and fame on TV were freaks of fortune. Born into poverty, deprived of a mother's love, repeatedly sent away, physically and sexually abused, impregnated at a young age. That's who Oprah had been. Who was she to fight fate? She should find a sensible job like her relatives and be content with her lot in life. Path two. One clear distinction remained between the agonizing experiences of her childhood and this conundrum at work. Choice. She did not choose to be born into hardship. She did not choose to repeatedly relocate in her childhood. And her choice was stolen from her at every instance of abuse. As an adult now, she could take a stand and entirely own who she was. She had Oprah's face and heart, not that of any other newscaster. So, she would interact with guests on the morning talk show as she deemed fit and connect with other human beings. What's the worst that could happen that wasn't already on the verge of occurring? Oprah's decision to shed the skin of an unbiased journalist with which she had always felt a disconnect and be her own person on People Are Talking is the exact reason that every viewer fell in love with her: her authenticity and openness. She honed her skills in the late 1970s and redefined the genre of talk shows. The spontaneous back and forth of actual human interaction, where she was more concerned with listening to others than spewing eloquent phrases, suited her. Her success on what was supposed to be a demotion led to her independent talk show in Chicago, one of the largest markets in the US. Oprah soon became a household name due to her obvious talent and mass appeal, and the show was eventually renamed to The Oprah Winfrey Show. Other talk shows did prop up, but they were more focused on orchestrating confrontations for cheap thrills. While the earlier episodes of Oprah's show were guilty of this practice too, she repurposed the format to make it more uplifting and spiritual. This cost her in the ratings initially, but her audience soon grew to admire her for it. It's also what she ascribes the longevity of her show to. From 6 million homes in the US in 1986, she ultimately reached the screens of over 100 countries. Lasting lesson. Life isn't a smooth ride. Not one among us is born into ideal circumstances or faces zero obstacles. It is true that some encounter much tougher troubles than others, and allowances must be made to let them cope in the way they choose. We should try not to despair, as there's always hope, a possibility to prevail. Metal is forged by hammer and anvil, but this external force does not change its elemental nature. While our experiences shape who we become, how much power we grant them depends wholly on us. Many use the terms fate and destiny interchangeably, but they are not the same. We can be resigned to our fates and believe we have no control over what happens to us. Or we could explore possibilities and work towards the potential of our destinies. Yes, life can be random and unfair, and we cannot exert our authority over every single aspect of the universe, but we do have choice. We make thousands of choices every day that many of us are fortunate to have full control over. We operate within the paradigm of our circumstances, but they can be molded by the sheer force of our will too. Life isn't about living through the motions as a passive spectator. After all, we all get one shot at this, so we might as well be active participants and carve our own way. We must remember that our destiny is in our own hands, since we are not our circumstances. And that was the moral of the story, the lasting lesson, and the title of the chapter, We Are Not Our Circumstances.
Like, love the portion that you spoke. And you. Especially the part where you actually come to the crossroad, it makes you think that what must she be thinking at that point of time? And yeah. What must be in her mind at that point? Like, was it something that she could have left to luck? Could it have been something that she could have actually chosen between those two paths? But coming to that, I'll just ask you a small question. Like, do you think sometimes it's that at a point, at a crossroad, people actually leave it to luck? Or do they actually deliberate? Or do they, or is it both at that point of time that goes further?
I think, I mean, when we're speaking of people, I think we all react in very different sorts of ways. There's no one way to react to a situation. That's a good thing that, you know, there are infinite ways to react to a situation. And that means that life is flexible. We can be flexible. But it's also a bit scary because that means there is no one right way to do something. And it's all like a hit and trial, I think, for all of us. And I don't know. I don't like generalizing human behavior. So I wouldn't say people do this or people do that. I agree with you that there are different ways to react to a situation. We could deliberate, but it depends on, you know, how many stress points there are on us at that point. If someone, like in Oprah's shoe, if she had like a full family that she had to support financially, or, you know, and she had a lot of stress points, a lot of stuff riding on her, just not for her own sake, but for like other people, like she had kids that she had to feed. That might have changed her decision. That might have changed how she reacted. I think it all depends on our circumstances, but we aren't them. Like, we can choose to do something that's a bit off-beaten, and that's not something that someone else would predict. Because just because you're born into a certain situation doesn't mean you're supposed to be stuck to it. Like, obviously, there are always limitations to what you can do. Like, money, power, all of these things play a huge factor. Education, access, where you live, whether you're living in a country that has great infrastructure, whether you have access to healthcare easily, like all of these things obviously impact your life. But even I think within your circumstances, there's always like some wiggle room to do something different, I believe.
So like from what I have like read in this chapter, I find the tone quite interesting. It's in a way being taken that it's more thoughtful rather than a preachy tone. So how important was this factor to you while writing?
It was honestly one of the biggest things that I used to ponder over and have like my own little like existential crisis over when I was writing this book. Because I was telling my parents, I would like sit with them every other day when I was working on this book, and I would say, why am I writing this book? It's not like I am some huge success story. It's not like I've had my own failures for sure, but nothing to compare with the people in the book, like nothing to compare, like not in that grand scale at all. And I'm like, why would anyone want to read my book? Like, what have I to say? Like, you know, and I realized it's actually not about me at all. It's about the people in this story. So once I changed my mindset that I am not, that they aren't listening to me, that's not why they're picking up the book. They're picking up the book to learn the stories of these people. And that is the biggest point of this book. I felt a lot better. I felt like I was the narrator of the story versus, you know, I'm someone who's like saying, do this, do that, which I didn't want to do at all, which is why I made some very like little, but I think impactful decisions, which is at no point in the book do I say you should do this or, you know, you can do this. I always say we, I say us, I say our, like even in the lessons, none of them says, you know, it doesn't say you are not your circumstances. It says we are not our circumstances. And it wasn't just a choice in like grammar or language. It was, like you said, it's a bit of a thoughtful choice because honestly, while researching and writing this book, I learned all of these lessons too. It's not like I picked up this book and I knew all of these lessons already and I was already applying them in my life. I understood them. I learned more about them as I did the research, as I learned about these people. And I basically just want to mold those stories into a lot more like bite-sized, easy to grasp and like fun. I believe that they're a bit fun and interesting to read chunks for all the readers. Because yeah, the amount of research I did and that's been squeezed into this like really like handy book, I think that you can carry anywhere with you. That's mm-hmm. been the whole part of the journey. Yeah.
So like researching on these 21 personas and reading about, like finding out so much about them. Do you think it is important to look at failures? And is it that as a society, we don't look at failures in with the proper attitude? Like I said, like we look at it very negatively. So do we need to look at it? Do we need to change our attitude towards failure?
I think so. I think coming from like the Indian middle class ethos, where I don't know how you felt, but I always felt like not just me and my family. I mean, I don't mean this is just like some pressure from my family, but I know they felt the same pressure. I know people around me felt the same pressure where, you know, you had to get the best marks in school. You had to study very hard. Then you had to do your, go to university, go to the best university that you can. And then with all the stress that we have regarding the cutoff points that increase every year, the cutoff marks, like, it's the pressure on children is unbelievable, but it doesn't stop there. Once you've got to the best university, you're supposed to again graduate with top marks. And then these days, even doing one degree is not enough. You have to do masters and then, you know, work hard at your job and keep climbing through, get promotions. And we do so much hard work and there's so much stress in our life because we believe that doing this and climbing the social ladder, the socioeconomic ladder, will ultimately lead to happiness because more money, more power means more freedom to provide for yourself and your family a better life. But there's just, we don't give, I think, ourselves any breathing space. We don't give ourselves any room to fail because we all will fail. Like, that is no secret. No one, like, the whole point of this book is that even these amazingly fantastic people have all struggled.
Yeah,
they were all struggling. They all failed. So if they can fail, why can't people like you and I fail then? You know, if people can, these people can fail at such a grand scale, why can't you have failures every single day? I think I have like a failure every single day. I'll have like a, you know, a checklist of things I'm supposed to do, but I will always miss like one or two items every day. And that's fine. We're all humans. We're going to make these mistakes. It's okay. Yeah. I think we do need to change our attitude towards failure because every day is just building so much stress and pressure on us, on kids these days. And I mean, you hear about people, you know, turning to like dark places and committing suicide.
And coming to this pandemic, it's even worse now. Like,
it's even worse. Yeah. It's especially right now. I think we need to all just like sort out what our priorities are and focus on a few things that we think we can do, because we won't be able to achieve everything right now in such a hard time. And it's the same for everyone. And we need to learn to be, this is one of the lessons in the book, and it's something I keep going back to, is learn to be kind to ourselves. I think that's mm-hmm. very, very important. Yeah.
So tell us about like new writing projects that you are working on presently.
So it's funny, like I said in the beginning, that I used to think of myself as a fiction writer, but finally the last few projects that I've done have been nonfiction. So this book has a nonfiction. I had a personal essay out earlier this year in a Scottish anthology called So Hormonal, and that's been nonfiction. I did some writing online, that's been nonfiction as well. But there's a novel that I've been working on for, it was, poor thing, was put on pause for like almost 2 years while I worked on 21 Fantastic Failures. Mm-hmm. And then I moved back to the UK to start my PhD. And I was getting in the zone of that. So I left my writing again aside. Yeah, so that novel is what I like to call political adventure fantasy, is the way I describe it. And it's set in India, and I still love the plot and the characters, but because I haven't touched it in 2 years, I think the writing needs to be updated a bit, because I think we grow every year. My writing improves every year, I like to believe. So I'm halfway through the first draft of that, so I need to get back to it and finish that. And I also have like ideas for some other fiction and nonfiction projects. So let's see what I get to first.
Yeah, switching to non-fiction from like to fiction, and non-fiction must be quite tough, like coming from all the books earlier which were fiction books, and then switching to a non-fiction book, looking at doing a lot of research and facts. How was it for you?
It was hard. So I have this thing where I procrastinate a lot, and luckily for me, most of the times it works. Like I can really like give it my all, but then I put so much pressure on myself in the last minute. But I somehow always get to like not just like scrape by. I get to like get by with like good feedback and good marks, etc., with good end results. So for my the dissertation that I wrote for my my master's in creative writing was was supposed to be 20,000 words of writing, and I chose to write 20,000 words of the novel that I just mentioned. And I was just putting it off. I went back home to India to visit my family. I was just, you know, chilling with them, relaxing with them. Mm-hmm. And I ultimately wrote those 20,000 words in like 3 or 4 weeks. While I had like 3 months to do it, I wrote them in like 3-4 weeks. And this book is 50,000 words. So when I came to this, I thought, oh yeah, that took like 3 weeks. And this, because it's double the amount and, you know, it requires research, let's say it'll take 3 months. I was so wrong. Because that novel, not to say that fiction doesn't require research, it does, especially when you're writing something like historical fiction, or you're writing about a subject that you don't know that much about. Even if it's like a crime thriller, you need to learn how the police deal with cases or how the law deals with cases. So there is research definitely involved in every kind of story. Mm-hmm. But nonfiction is like a separate thing, especially something like this book, because I started the research, and for every chapter, I would spend just like, I think I spent 90% of the time on this book on research. When I had to sit down to actually write the chapters, that went by really quick. Thankfully, I write really fast when I'm in the zone. But to be in the zone, I first had to do all the research. And for each chapter, I had separate Word documents with all the research. And that ranged from 20,000 to like 40,000 words for each person. So I had to squeeze those 40,000 words to these bite-sized like 2,500 word chapters, and that was a huge task. First, obviously, collecting all that research, because I didn't want to stick to just one source. I went through different kinds of media formats, I went through different sources, and every detail, every fact that's present in this book has been corroborated by at least 2 sources, if not more, and reliable sources.
Right.
So doing that and then squeezing that into chapters, and I didn't want the chapters to be very information heavy either. Like I didn't want the person to just get like stressed out as if they're learning for school while reading this, because that's one of the things I don't like about nonfiction, when it's just like a huge overload of information and you can't process the meat of the story, because the point of these stories is not to be like, this person was born on this day in this city and this have like 2 sisters and, you know, parents did this and they went to the school. That information is present in this book, but that's not the point. The point is to say, this was their journey. The reason I've given their life like chronologically and as a biography is so that we can understand their situation, their context, so that when they come to that crossroads, we know, okay, this is how they could have probably acted, because it would make complete sense in this situation. But this is the work step they took, and this is the different step they took, and this is how they actually behaved. So doing that was a huge journey, but I have received feedback saying that It's smooth, the chapters are smooth, and you don't feel like you're reading a lot. But once you've shut down the book, when you put the book aside, you realize that you have learned a lot, actually. But hopefully in a fun, interesting way, because that's what I want my stories to be.
No, the way it's been carved into stories, somehow they remain in your head, and somehow they make an impact in your head, because we tend to relate to stories more, and we relate to rather than more information. If it's in a story, you somehow have that thing in your head when you are actually acting on something, and that helps as a lesson as well.
I think that is the power of storytelling. That's the power of stories. Like stories we heard from our grandparents or our parents while growing up, you know, India has such a rich tradition of oral storytelling. Those stories will always stay with us. We might not remember the character names, we might not remember the exact situation, But we still remember the events and the flow of, and what the, like I said, what the meat of the story is, what the point is, what, and a lot of these stories like that we heard in our childhood also had morals. So those remain present with us always.
Right. Muskan, do you have any questions which you you have from the audience, or if, or else I have a lot of questions.
You continue.
I might actually call up Sonali and ask those questions now.
So we can have a conversation later as well. Yeah.
So yeah, like, tell us about where your books are available, how, like, everybody can read them. I'm sure after listening to all this stuff, they really want to go and read them now.
Yeah, my book 21 Fantastic Failures, it's right here, it's a nice bright yellow cover, is available in bookshops across India. And it will actually help if you call up your local bookshop and ask them, hey, do you have this book? And if they don't, tell them to get this book, and that will help me a lot, and that will, you know, help this book a lot. And but it should be available in all bookshops across India. And if not that, it's available on Amazon and Flipkart, and it's also available internationally, actually, on Amazon as well. And if you prefer hard copies, you have books, but if you're a Kindle reader, there are ebooks as well that you can get online.
So coming to that, if there are things we if Sonali has something to share as a closing note, please.
Just that I hope you enjoy reading this book, and if you do, and even if you don't, you have some feedback for me, I would appreciate if you could write reviews online. That really helps new authors, especially whether that's on Flipkart's website, Amazon's website, or even Goodreads app if you use that. And you can stay up to date with my writing journey and even my research journey at my website, which is www.sonalimisra.com, so easy to remember that way. And you can also follow me on social media. I am on Twitter at Misra Sonali, and I am on Instagram at sonali.writes.
So coming to this, at this point of time, I think we are at a point where failures are something which are more talked about. A lot of people are now talking about failure. A lot of people are now expressing what they went through. A lot of people have started expressing their struggles rather than just being showing a very golden picture to everybody. So the book gives us a perspective of those 21 people, and we need to research on more people to learn more things from other people as well, and maybe the ones who live next to us also. So Muskan, over to you is now.
On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, I would like to thank our speaker, Sonali Misra ma'am, and our moderator, Kritika Dhanwate ma'am, for joining us today. We all are inspired by your great words. Thank you so much. And I would also like to extend my gratitude towards Rupa Publication for their constant support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, thanks.
20 years of existence. Two universities, 23 educational institutes, offering 137 courses. Rice Oni Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.